Hello friends, in this video, we will discuss about the various methods of gingival retraction in fixed prosthodontics. So the procedure to expose the subgingival finish lines of preparation may be termed as gingival displacement, gingival retraction, gingival deflection, and gingival dilatation. So the gingival retraction is the deflection of the marginal gingiva away from a tooth. The objectives of gingival retraction are: it is used to widen the gingival sulcus. It helps in obtaining the perfect die with accurate margins of restoration. It indirectly prevents marginal caries, plaque accumulation, and marginal gingivitis. Then it helps in blending of the restoration with the unprepared tooth surface. It is used to enhance access and to prevent damage to the soft tissue during cavity preparation. And while cementation, it helps in easy removal of cement without tissue damage. So to achieve gingival retraction, the gingival tissues must be healthy and free of inflammation. Cervical margins should be placed in the appropriate position. The optimum position of the margins is 0.5 mm from the healthy free gingival margins or 3 to 4 mm from the crest of the alveolar bone. The gingival tissues can be displaced laterally and vertically. Lateral retraction displaces the tissue so that an adequate bulk of impression material can be interfaced with the prepared tooth. The vertical retraction exposes the unprepared portion of the tooth apical to finish line. Coming to the techniques of gingival retraction. The technique for gingival displacement can be classified as conservative techniques, which include mechanical and chemicomechanical methods, and radical or surgical procedures, which include rotary gingival curettage or gingittage and electrosurgical methods. Now coming to the mechanical methods. Mechanical methods of gingival displacement were among the first developed. These methods involved physical displacement of the gingival tissue by placement of materials within the gingival sulcus. The materials can be used alone or in conjunction with the other methods. So under mechanical methods, we use rubber dam. The retraction is produced when the heavy weight rubber dam compresses the tissue. According to Gilmore, it can be called gum compression rather than gum retraction. It is used when limited number of teeth in one quadrant are being restored and in situations in which preparation do not have to be extended very far subgingivally. It should not be used with polyvinyl siloxane impression material because the rubber dam is made up of latex, which can interfere with the polymerization of polyvinyl siloxane impression material. Coming to the copper band, the technique has been utilized in restorative dentistry for many years. It serves as a means of carrying the impression material as well as a mechanism of displacing the gingiva. With copper band, we can use impression compound or elastomeric impression material. Coming to the retraction cord, this is the method of choice as the availability is not a problem and the application is extremely easy. So here, plain cotton thread, unwaxed floss, cotton synthetic cord, untreated surgical silk or elastic retraction rings can be used. The retraction cord can be used wet or dry. A thinner grade cord is used around the anterior teeth and a thicker one around the posterior teeth. So retraction cords are available in three varieties: loose, twisted, braided and knitted. Braided and knitted variety does not separate when they are pushed into the sulcus and so they are easier to use. Retraction cords are available in different sizes, starting from 000, which is extra small in size, to 3 number, which is extra large, and these retraction cords are color coded. Now coming to the chemicomechanical methods. This method aims at combining chemical action with pressure packing, enlargement of the gingival sulcus, as well as control of fluids seeping from the walls of the gingival sulcus. So the chemicals used are broadly classified as vasoconstrictors, drugs with styptic action, and astringents. The vasoconstrictors physiologically restrict the blood supply by decreasing the size of the blood capillaries. The agents usually used are 1:1000 epinephrine and higher concentrations of epinephrine. The retraction is achieved in 10 minutes. The epinephrine is contraindicated in some of the conditions, such as patients who are hypersensitive to epinephrine, in patients with cardiovascular disorders, patients with pacemaker, in cases of hyperthyroidism, and in patients on drugs such as rauwolfia compound, ganglionic blockers, and epinephrine potentiating drugs. The advantages of epinephrine are that it is vasoconstrictive in nature and it provides hemostasis. The disadvantages are that it can cause systemic effects like epinephrine syndrome. There is a risk of inflammation of gingival cuff and it can cause tissue necrosis. Styptics are the biologic fluid coagulants which locally coagulate blood and tissue fluids, creating the surface layer which is an efficient sealant against blood and crevicular fluid seepage. The examples are 100% alum solution, 5-25% aluminium chloride, 10% aluminium potassium sulfate, and 15-25% tannic acid. The cord saturated with 100% alum can be safely left in sulcus for as long as 20 minutes without adverse effects. The advantages are that it provides hemostasis. There is least inflammation of all agents used with cords, and there is little sulcus collapse after cord removal. The disadvantages are that it has an offensive taste and there is a risk of necrosis if it is used in high concentrations. Aluminium chloride is most commonly used in the concentrations of 5% and 25%. The advantages are that it does not cause any systemic effect, it provides hemostasis, and there is little sulcus collapse after cord removal. The disadvantages are that it provides less vasoconstriction than epinephrine, there is risk of sulcus contamination, it modifies surface detailed reproduction, and it inhibits set of polyvinyl siloxane and polyether impressions. The advantage of ferric sulfate solution is that it provides hemostatic action. The disadvantages are that ferric sulfate causes tissue discoloration. It has an acidic taste. There is risk of sulcus contamination and it inhibits set of polyvinyl siloxane and polyether impression materials. Now coming to the techniques of cord placement. So there are four techniques: single cord technique, double cord technique, infusion technique, and the every other tooth technique. So for single cord technique, the operating area must be dry. A length of gingival retraction cord is selected to specifically match the anatomy of each individual gingival sulcus. Then the retraction cord should be moistened by dipping it in buffered 25% aluminium chloride solution in a dipping dish. Then the cord is twisted to make it as tight and as small as possible. And a loop of retraction cord is formed around the tooth and held tautly with the thumb and forefinger. The Then placement of retraction cord is begun by pushing it into the sulcus on the mesial surface of the tooth. Then it should be tacked into the distal surface. Then the cord is being placed subgingivally. The instrument must be pushed slightly toward the area already tugged into place. And if the force of the instrument is directed away from the area previously pegged, the cord will be pulled out. The instrument must be angled slightly toward the root to facilitate the subgingival placement of the cord. And after the cord is in place, the tooth preparation is carefully inspected. Then we need to wait for 8 to 10 minutes before removing the cord and making the impression. The cord needs time to effect adequate lateral displacement, and the medicament needs time to create hemostasis and crevicular fluid control. The double cord technique is used when making impressions in cases of multiple prepared teeth or when the tissue health is compromised. So in this case, first we place a thinner grade retraction cord, and over that we place a thick retraction cord to achieve the gingival retraction. The infusion technique was given by Danny Fisher in 1981. Here the hemorrhage is controlled using a specifically designed dental infusion with a ferric sulfate medicament. The medicament is extruded from the syringe or infusion as the instrument is manipulated around the gingival sulcus. When hemostasis is verified, a knitted retraction cord is soaked in the ferric sulfate solution and pegged into the sulcus. Then the cord remains in place 1 to 3 minutes. The cord is removed and the sulcus is rinsed with water and the impression is made. The dental infusion and the 20% ferric sulfate have proven to be an effective ancillary technique for control of hemorrhage when using the single cord technique. Next technique is every other tooth technique. When making impressions of anterior tooth preparations, it is critical that no damage is done to the gingival tissues that may result in recession. With teeth with root proximity, placing retraction cord simultaneously around all prepared teeth may result in strangulation of the gingival papillae and eventual loss of the papilla. This creates anesthetic black triangles in the gingival embrasures. This can be used with the single or double cord technique. The retraction cord is placed around the most distal prepared tooth, and then no cord is placed around the prepared tooth mesial to the most distal tooth. The retraction procedures are completed on alternate teeth. Coming to the surgical methods. So, rotary curettage was first described by Amsterdam in 1954 and subsequently modified by Ingraham. Rotary curettage is a troughing technique which produces limited removal of epithelial tissue in the sulcus. It is used with the subgingival placement of restoration margins. So it is usually done simultaneously along the finish line preparation. A torpedo nose diamond of 150 to 180 grade is used to extend the finish line apically. The bur should be extended into the gingival sulcus to remove a portion of the sulcular epithelium. Then the cord impregnated with aluminium chloride or alum is gently placed to control hemorrhage. The cord is removed after 4 to 8 minutes and the sulcus is thoroughly irrigated with water. This technique is well suited for use with reversible hydrocolloid impression material. The disadvantages are that there is poor tactile sensation when using diamonds on sulcular walls, which can produce deepening of the sulcus, and the technique also has the potential for destruction of periodontium if used incorrectly. Coming to the electrosurgical methods, D. Arsonval in 1891 explained that electricity at high frequency will pass through a body without producing a shock, instead produce an increase in temperature. So the basic concept is that intentional passage of high frequency waveforms or the currents through the tissues of the body to achieve a controllable effect. When these waveforms pass through it, intracellular heat is produced within the tissues contacted by active electrode tip. This heat volatilizes cells, and as the electrode is guided through the tissue, it leaves a path of cell destruction in the path of an incision or surface coagulation. By varying the mode of this current, the clinician can use electrosurgical unit for cutting or coagulation of soft tissues. The use of electrosurgery has been recommended for enlargement of the gingival sulcus and control of hemorrhage to facilitate impression making. The electrosurgery unit is a high frequency oscillator or a radio transmitter that uses either a vacuum tube or a transistor to deliver high frequency electrical current at least 1 MHz. It has been called surgical diathermy. Electrosurgery produces a controlled tissue destruction to achieve a surgical result. The current flows from a small cutting electrode that produces a high current density and a rapid temperature rise at the point of contact with tissues. 5 commonly used electrosurgical electrodes includes coagulating electrode, diamond loop, round loop, small straight and small loop electrode. Now coming to the procedure of electrosurgery, the electrosurgical scalpel is plugged into the active outlet. Then we place a drop of pleasant smelling aromatic oil at the vermilion border of upper lip. The cutting electrode must be applied with very light pressure and should be guided, not pushed through the tissue. To prevent lateral penetration of heat into tissue with subsequent injury, the electrode should be kept moving and no stroke is repeated immediately. At least 8 to 10 seconds of gap to be given before repeating the stroke. The high volume suction tip must be plastic to prevent burns. For a proper technique, the following points are important. Proper power setting, quick passes with the electrode, adequate line interval between strokes. The wire is held parallel to the long axis of the tooth so that the tissue is removed from the inner wall of the sulcus, and the whole tooth should be encompassed in 4 separate motions, that is facial, mesial, lingual and distal. Then a cotton pellet dipped in hydrogen peroxide is used to clean debris from the sulcus, and the tissue healing is rapid with this procedure. The subgingival trough heals in 5 to 7 days. The advantages of electrosurgery are that it provides excellent vision of margins, it results in immediate hemostasis, there is predictable healing of the tissues, it results in improved accuracy of the impression by providing more bulk of material at the margins, there is decreased chair time and stress for the dentist and the patient, it has an ability to remove irregular or excess tissue around the teeth, there is minimal post-operative discomfort for the patient, and it results in decreased cross-infection. The disadvantages are that it has an offensive odor or taste, so we need high volume suction. It is a technique sensitive procedure. There is little tactile feedback. It may cause trauma to the near tooth or soft tissues, and it is an expensive procedure. The contraindications for electrosurgery are: it cannot be done in patients with cardiac pacemakers. It should not be used in conjunction with flammable gases, and also the use of topical anesthetics such as ethyl chloride in patients with expected abnormal healing process such as diabetes mellitus and blood dyscrasias, and in irradiated patients. So if you like this video, then please share it with your friends and subscribe to our channel. And in the end, thank you for watching.